for coming. This is our core crowd for our annual Christmas bird count, which is coming up this Saturday. And this is a presentation that I give each winter in preparation for the count. And in this presentation, I'm going to change it up a little bit. You guys have seen me do the same presentation for several years in a row, where I try to go over every bird that occurs here in the winter, which isn't a huge number, but it has gotten a little bit monotonous to me, if nobody else. And I boiled it down. Aaron Lang, when he was here, gave one of the best presentations I've ever seen. And he's an expert birder that used to live here, for those of you who might not know. And the presentation he gave at the Science Center was one of the first few years I lived here. It was about gull ID. And they can be very difficult. You know, there's a lot of similarities to how they look. Well, he picked four species and the different ages and how they, the different plumages evolve, and how long it takes for them to get. And he just bit off a digestible chunk and presented. He's a great educator, and anyway, he did a great job with that. So with that in mind, I've bitten off a smaller chunk of birds. And maybe each year we can take a different group of birds, before the Christmas bird count for a review. So that was my intention here. And anyway, several questions. This is a little outline of what I'm going to do tonight. Several questions that I want to answer or to present to you guys. Last year, with all those birds that came to our feeders, I was getting questions constantly, like, what's going on? And so I want to talk about that, the eruption of winter finches. I want to talk about the Eurasian collared doves, which are invading North America, actually the world, and talk about LBBs or LBJs. Anybody know what those are?
Little brown birds.
Little brown birds or little brown jobbies. We're going to talk about those. That's the digestible chunk I'm going to bite off today, and then a little outline for our Christmas bird count. Before I jump into this any further, though, the sign-up sheet is coming around. I'm fixing our email list, and some of you might have got an email that haven't got them recently. I know I still have yours wrong. I get a rejection there. If you did not get an email about this meeting from me about this meeting and the Christmas bird count, make sure your email is on there. And if you're interested in Christmas bird counts, put a little check there so I'll make sure that you're on my list. Libby, I think I have yours wrong.
This is my source.
Okay. Did you get it? Me?
No, I just saw it on the scanner.
Yeah, so make sure I have a current email address from you as well. Several in this room, I know I have it wrong. So Carolyn, if you can get yours on there too, I'll try to get it. Is anybody, I know people are seeing some neat stuff, so what are people seeing out there? We like to review winter or bird sightings, and not just birds, but whales and stuff. If you got some, what have you guys seen?
We came back in from the sound on Sunday and entered the circle area of the count. And out of 7 days all around the sound, the only pigeon guillemot we had was off Humpback Creek. That was kind of neat. And we did have a humpback whale north of North Island that I probably would have put in the count circle just to put it on there. But a lot of loons, that's always one. I always have to review the winter plumage on, especially the, the Pacific and common and red-throated are always a little harder to pick out, especially from a distance in the winter. But we saw all four of them in the 7 days, but not all within the count area.
Anybody else?
No black-legged kittiwakes either.
Oh, is that right? None?
Yeah, none at all. Mews and glaucous-winged gulls, maybe a herring gull. Double-crested cormorant and regular cormorant, but there again, there could be those light-billed ones we've talked about.
Yeah, and those if they're red-faced or not.
Yeah, the red-faced winter or not.
Anybody else? What did you find dead in Eccles Lagoon?
I didn't find that. I didn't put that on.
Oh, you didn't?
No, I'm not sure.
Oh, I would have sworn that was you. There were, I got a bunch of things to rattle off if nobody else has things. There were a handful of Bohemian wax wings in town.
Oh,
yeah. And they're not an easy one to get on Christmas bird count. In fact, not an easy one to see in Cordova. And our berry trees are mostly stripped. But still, that's worth keeping your eyes. And somebody wrote down on our board downstairs, found a dead one in Eccles Lagoon.
Milo, where have you been seeing them?
In my office. I was in my office, and I keep a bird feeder, but they're generally not attracted to feeders. And I heard a thump on the window, and I looked up and didn't see anything, so I went back to work. Then I heard a thump on the window again. I look up, and here's a Bohemian waxwing flying away. And that same week, downstairs, Bob saw one out his window. So those are the sightings that those two sightings were just around the office.
You know, my feeders are empty.
And we saw one at the far end of Hawkins Island when we were deer hunting one day.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So what else? Yeah, they can be elusive. I think we're seeing some winter wrens, certainly on Hawkins Island, but I think around town also. Good. Let's just hope they are there on Saturday and that the weather lets us find them. We've got a little change in the weather coming too. I'm forgetting all these things, these birds.
There's been some pine grosbeaks around.
Oh.
Which saw them up on the ski hill, actually.
Okay.
And I've heard other people saying they've been seen occasionally.
Yeah, and we've seen them in the forest, not near feeders or anything.
Some years they're, you know, they're just real sporadic.
Uh-huh. Susan Ogle told me yesterday that she found a glaucus gull, first or second year glaucus gull at the burn or the meat pile off the Orca Road there. That's always a good one for us to get because we always get glaucus wing gulls, but glaucus gulls can be kind of hard to find. And Paul Schwartzbart said just yesterday or day before he saw a northern hawk owl like right before the windsock or between the windsock and the airport, somewhere just before the airport on the highway. That's always a really good one for whoever has the highway route. And my feeder, yeah, feeders are slow. At my window, I'm getting red-breasted nuthatches here at the office. Got a steady flow of chickadees, chestnut-backed chickadees. And those Eurasian collared doves are coming to my yard. And that's going to be really interesting. You got two last year, right, Bill?
Three.
Oh, you got three.
We saw two in one spot and then a single.
That you were calling later. Three birds. I forgot.
It could have been one of the same, but
yeah.
We called it three.
Okay, I forgot that it was three and not two. And I've seen three in my yard at one time, several times this fall. Anyway, I'm going to go into more detail about those, but I've heard one report of somebody seeing four, so at one time.
I heard one in the graveyard in October.
Oh, cool. Yeah, people are hearing them around town. I still have not heard one calling, but I know for several years I've heard people report that. Okay.
You've got Valdez. You've got a couple people in Valdez if you want to ask them.
Oh, Valdez folks. Do you guys have a Christmas bird count?
No, we haven't had one in many years.
Okay, someone needs to start one up.
You're the last one.
Well, we tried, but even at our peak, we never had the 12 people that you need to have. I tried to start one a few years ago.
Okay.
There's a minimum, and you have to register in March. I mean, there's a bunch of hoops, and we don't have it together.
Oh, okay.
I'm sorry to say.
Yeah. Any interesting sightings or neat birds around there?
Not anything unusual yet.
Okay.
Just the usual stuff.
Okay. And by the way, this picture right here, if you saw the little blurb in the paper about the piece that the museum bought, is the photograph that the museum bought from me just recently, Dennis, thank you very much. In fact, Dennis picked it out. It's blown up 20 by 30, and it's printed on metal, which might sound tacky if nothing else, but it's the first large print I've done on metal. It's on aluminum, and it's super high gloss. It's really got depth to it. I'm really impressed with how it turned out. So if you get a chance, go to the library meeting room where it's hanging. And thanks very much, Dennis, for facilitating all that. With that, okay.
Is it not working now?
Yeah.
Technology can be.
It worked earlier.
Yeah, it did. But did it work better me standing over here?
Shouldn't matter.
I wonder just because it went dormant.
Christmas harmonica. Get it together.
It's us older folks. Kids.
It's all Milo's fault.
Give it to a kid. They'll figure it out.
Okay, so I got lots of phone calls last year about what was going on with the birds, and we were invaded, and actually we weren't alone, because much of North America experienced this invasion of what's called winter finches. And winter finches include, I mean, birds that are commonly involved in these eruptions are pine grosbeaks, red crossbills, white-winged crossbills, purple finch. Pine siskin is a big component of what we see here, and common redpolls are a huge component of what we see here during invasion years like that. But also red crossbills got added to the mix this year, which, yeah, we have them around here. Usually if you see them, there's a small group in the top of a spruce, but they were mobbing feeders, and we got the best looks you could ever hope for, which I'll show here in a little bit. Anyway, it was really impressive, and you couldn't help but notice it. And like Alaska Millen Feed in Anchorage was sold out of bird seed. It was very hard to buy bird seed, and they were emptying feeders daily. Hundreds of these things were around individual feeders. So it was a really spectacular. But people were asking, what's going on? You know, what's happening? Well, what it is it typically is a change in the food supply somewhere where these birds normally live. And these guys might live right around us most of the time, except for they're just in the alders or in the spruce eating cones, catkins, most of the time. And the natural food sources just keep them scattered in the woods. Well, the boreal forest, where a lot of these birds live and breed, lies across the whole northern tier of North America, from Alaska through Canada, from here to the East Coast. And so there's a huge range for these birds to be dispersed. But when their food crops fail, they have to go somewhere else looking for food, and they'll go to the lower 48, they'll come here, they'll go somewhere, and that's what why they suck into feeders like they did. Is there anything I didn't cover here? Anyway, I went over the species that are mostly covered. Common redpolls, which are the main one that we were seeing, especially at first, feed on the catkins of birch and alder. When their production is low, these birds have to erupt to areas where there are more food, which is people's bird feeders, or at least that's one source. And these things can be extensive. And this year, I was reading reports of them throughout the Pacific Northwest, across the country, the northern tier, and even further south than the northern tier of states. Anyway, it was a widespread eruption. I love it because I get to photograph some birds I don't normally get to photograph, and most of these pictures are mine. And I did notice something when I was putting this together. I get tunnel vision in my photography, and I get obsessed with capturing the beauty of small individual birds. But when I was putting this together, I had to realize, whoa, I didn't really have a flock of birds, anything that showed an eruption. And Opie came by the office today, great timing. And he had a neat little video that he took with his, and still pictures that he took with his iPhone of his feeder last year, which I've thrown in here. That kind of illustrates better what these individual pictures do. This is taken from eBird. It's a really neat website where people can report individual sightings, and it's compiled nationally and synthesized, and you can look at data however way you want. This isn't a real drastic illustration. I just picked 2 years. I didn't really spend much time looking. But in 2010, which I'm assuming was not an invasion year, I looked up common redpoll for the whole year, and this is where the bulk of the sightings occurred. And last year, which I knew to be a big eruption, you can see the shift in sightings. And it's not super drastic, but you can see, first of all stations get darker purple, have more sightings, and there's a shift south between those given years. So that's an illustration, and you can see the South Central Alaska definitely shows this. Well, maybe they show it both time periods. I think it gets darker here in this 2000. Well, that's the pre-eruption period. Anyway, you can see that shift south. Not real dramatic, but that's what an eruption is. It started out with these pine siskins, and for the longest time, I didn't see a redpoll early last winter. There was large numbers of pine siskins, and they kept growing and growing. In fact, this is a difficult bird to find right now. This is one we're going to be sweating out on Saturday for the Christmas bird count. Opie says he's got a few individuals. Whoever does the town route might be going to his yard, or maybe we'll hear of some others feeders that have. Have you guys have any pine siskins coming?
I just got home last night, but my feeders are empty. I mean, they're full.
Oh,
I don't think
nothing's
been
touching
a lot of activity
it.
On
yeah. Yeah, it might be hard to come up with a pine siskin of all things. But anyway, they started occurring in great numbers and draining our feeders early on. And, this just shows some of the color variation. Some of them can be quite bright, have quite a bit of yellow on them. This was one in my backyard. And I was over in Girdwood for a weekend early last winter, and they had a lot of pine grosbeaks coming to their feeders. We don't really get them at our feeders all that often. They're around in the forest right now.
And are they always red like that?
Well, yes, I'll show you the difference. The males are bright red like this, yes. And they're a real striking bird, and people are seeing them on the ski hill, like Bill just reported. And they're oftentimes a fairly tame bird, even away from feeders. They'll let you get kind of close. Anyway, I enjoyed feeding them. This is what a female looks like right here. They're that yellowish-orange color. Anyway, I had a good time photographing them. And again, I think they were part of this eruption. And then the red poles started coming in. And I remember looking at the flocks in my yard here in Cordova. And, first it was 10 or 20% red poles and the rest pine siskins. And that just steadily grew through the winter. This is from an eruption a few years ago. Maybe they're starving. There could be some pressures on them, but you can put seed in your hands, and they were doing this winter, landing on your feet or landing in your hand or landing on my camera while I'm photographing one 10 feet away. It's amazing how bold or naive they can get. Pretty mean looking little guys. Anyway, I had a blast photographing them, and I'm definitely, when I'm photographing, looking for the prettiest ones. It's not necessarily a good cross-section of how they look. I love these ones, probably the males that have these lovely splashes of red on their foreheads and breasts, like this one here. And this one, gorgeous bird. So I was really enjoying them. And then I thought it was so neat when a couple of red crossbills showed up. And, I thought it was going to be a fleeting thing, and I was photographing some of them in my backyard. There might have been one or two. Well, I won't say that they were out competing or outnumbering the red poles, but they really made a showing, and I had a blast photographing them. And if you look close at these pictures, can you see those bill, the bill tip on these? And I hope last winter you got a chance to see them. They're a strange bird that has a bill that crosses like this, and it's adapted for pulling or extracting the seeds from cones, from spruce cones or pine cones. And it's really dramatic when you can see them in real life. And so I was really enjoying getting a chance to photograph them. And they kind of come in a wide spectrum of colors. The males can be bright red, the females are yellowish, and then there's these young males that can be from yellowish to orange. And here's an orange one, a juvenile male right here, that shows the crossbill really well. Here's a beautiful dark red male, snowflake on his head. And here's probably a female perched on some cones. I had these great little props in my yard that I would throw seed around and sit just 15 feet away and let them land on it. And just had a blast photographing these guys. And here's a beautiful male, a red male that has a nice cross bill and really nice light. So anyway, this eruption was just spectacular, and it's not super common to get lots of red crossbills. And I was looking at Alaska bird notes from other parts of the state. People were fortunate just to see one or two, and some people were traveling to Anchorage or to Homer just to see, or to Girdwood to see a couple. We, I think, had this best, at least as far as what I was hearing, or we had it pretty good. We got a really large number, and we were having 20 and 30 or 50 at a time. And I think right here, this is the video that Opie sent. And before I play it, you can see all the different age ranges from the yellow, greenish females to the bright red males and the orange young males. And and how long did it take Opie for them to drain this feeder?
I
That, and the amazing thing was, I didn't see one of them until one morning I got up and I walked out into the living room and looked out the window, and it looked just like that. Just in one day, and it stayed that way for 2 months.
Yeah.
Wow.
It was like that every day for a month, and then they slowly dwindled.
I just now thought of some pictures that I did not put in this presentation, but in my photography, I was spending some time with these things, and I got the impression that whereas that bill might be really good for getting seeds out of cones, it might not have been the best for just eating a cone that's, or a seed that's just laying there. And they would grab a seed and fly into the spruce tree, and they would have to set it on something to eat, and those damn siskins and redpolls figured this out, and they were stealing the seeds from them left and right. So they would land on the branch with the seed, and I got pictures of them stealing seeds on several occasions. Anyway, that was pretty cool to see. So anyway, that was an amazing event, and we have had redpoll and siskin eruptions in other years, but that's the best by far I've seen of the red crossbills. And anyway, enjoy it when it does happen, and I'm stocked with all this bird seed now in case that happens, but you just have to be ready for it. The next thing I wanted to talk about is the Eurasian collared dove. They're taking over the world, and I did a little bit of research for this. First of all, they're native to, this is just how to identify them. They basically look like a mourning dove in shape. They're a little bit larger, and they're pale, they're whitish, and they have a black ring over the back of their neck. This collar, the collar is a narrow black crescent. So anyway, these are some of the characteristics to look for. We don't get very many mourning doves here. We don't have any rock doves or pigeons. So if you see a dove, it's going to be this in Cordova right now. It's going to be the Eurasian collared dove. I was looking up where they're from, and I didn't realize, because it's called a Eurasian collared dove, I assumed they were from Europe and Asia, but they weren't from there. Originally, they occurred just in a part of Asia, in this temperate to subtropical Asia, east of Turkey and southern China, an area like that. Well, in the first half of the 1950s, they invaded Europe and made it all the way to Britain and north to Norway by the 1950s. So they spread west and north across Europe and Asia and took over Asia in the recent past. And then a few were introduced to the Bahamas in the 70s. And from there, they made their way to Florida by the 1980s, and now when I tell you they're taking over the world, I'm not exaggerating. And this is a picture of one sitting on a branch at Muse Apartments when they were first showing up. And here's one I think was in my yard a few years ago. Shows that black collar and just that kind of whitish appearance, a little bit lighter colored than a mourning dove. But I went to eBird again, and I wanted to see how the data showed how they have taken over the country, and this is really drastic. This is 1990, and it shows the little purple squares are where they were recorded on eBird from that time period. And there could have been a few other introductions, like in the Southern California, Los Angeles area, or maybe around Seattle. Maybe in cities a few were introduced additionally. But look at this, in 5 years, Florida is getting pretty well covered, and there's a few other sporadic locations. That I don't know. It's off the chart here. Yeah, they could have been sample sites that were measured and didn't have them. I'll have to check on that, go to the eBird site. So there's 2000. There's 2005. There's 2010, and then here's this past year. They are taking the country by storm. And I looked at the ecological effects. I mean, invasive species could be a real terrible thing to a lot of native wildlife. And they seem to be filling a niche. First of all, the effects aren't known. They seem to be filling a niche in between mourning dove and rock pigeon, the city pigeon. My observations around here is that they're largely around human developed areas in cities. They In comparison, the starling, which is an introduced bird, uses tree cavities and can outcompete native cavity nesters. These birds aren't, you know, outcompeting a nesting niche like that. So I'd like to think or hope they're kind of benign and not hurting other wildlife, but just time will tell that, and their numbers could be a reason for concern. But anyway, I thought eBird illustrated this really well.
Taking up the space left by passenger pigeon.
Yeah, yeah, you know.
All I have to get is a deleterious.
So I wonder if
we want to see
them. Yeah, you know.
I wonder if they're moving towards the US, or are they just becoming more popular everywhere?
They're becoming more popular everywhere. They did this to Europe already. And this is a separate population from Europe's population. They're not coming from Europe to here. They're just increasing here that rapidly is what it looks like.
So what keeps their population numbers down where they're native?
I don't know. Well, whatever it was, it appears to have disappeared because they've taken off from wherever they evolved, or you know, in that smaller part of Asia. They took off from there and you know, conquered Europe and you know, the rest of Asia. And they're working on North America. So anyway, I keep a spreadsheet on bird sightings, and it's not scientific. It's just sort of opportunistic. Whenever I hear things or something that strikes me as noteworthy, or you know, a bird that's good for Cordova, I write it down. And so what I did is I went to my spreadsheet and looked for when I started getting these Eurasian collared dove sightings. And Julius Reynolds, who is a predecessor of Charlotte, a fish and game biologist here, he has a cabin on the lower Eyak, and he comes here and does some hunting and spends some time at his cabin. He reported and had pictures. I'll show you his picture in a minute. In 2009, he had one walking on the boardwalk to his cabin on the lower Eyak. That's the first that I know of one showing up here. And anyway, that was, you know, weird. You know, didn't think that much about it and didn't know that much about the Eurasian collared dove at that time. The next summer, Merle Hansen, who lives out at Five Mile Loop, I believe, he was sending me some pictures, and he came into the office to tell me about Eurasian collared dove, a single bird that he was seeing on his porch feeder. And it was sticking around for a little while, and he had a poor picture at first, then he got a better picture, and he was curious what it was. I looked it up for him, and he saw that for a while, then it disappeared. And around the time it disappeared, there started to be sightings of a single bird here in town around Bruce Campbell's place on Railroad Row, and Alyssa and Kurt's place. There were some sightings in there, and then some sightings started to become kind of regular up the hill here at Mew's apartment. And they kind of gravitated to there, and that bird started wintering there. A woman was feeding birds in the parking lot of Mew's apartments. And that bird spent the winter, and I believe we got it on the Christmas bird count, just a single bird. It stayed as a single bird for a while. And then that started changing. In 2011, there were a lot of reports of a single bird often calling at this point. And I got a report of a pair on November 5th. In 2012, there were regular reports of a pair, including on our Christmas bird count. And I'm mistaken there. Bill reported those two together. And then an hour later, a mile away or half a mile away, an individual bird, and wasn't sure to call that three, but it could have been three birds that he saw on our count last year. And Jason Fodi's wife, who lives right up here, Denise, has seen four at the same time in her yard, and I've seen three many times in my yard this fall. So they're definitely increasing in town, and that'll be a fun one Saturday on the Christmas bird count, to try to get people to take notes of where and when they're seeing them, and see if we can get a handle on how many are in town. And Dana, you saw one this summer out the road?
At the airport.
At the airport? I had the feeling some might have been coming, you know, moving north. There was a newspaper girl. Jennifer Gibbons was camping at Alleghanic quite a bit, and she had one hanging out at her campsite there at Alleghanic. So anyway, some birds from outside of town seem to be coming, and there's definitely more in town right now. I don't know if they've reproduced, but that's certainly likely at this point. So that's the history, as I know it, of these birds in Cordova. This is Julius Reynolds' picture of the one, maybe the first one to get here out at Eyak, the lower Eyak River. And this is a picture, I think, from 2010 that Mark Hoover took right up here at Muse Apartments. This is one of the ones that was wintering up there.
I know they have some pigeons in Valdez, but do they have anybody seen any there?
I don't. Oh, do you guys know about the Eurasian collared dove in Valdez?
I don't believe I've ever seen one in Valdez, nor have I heard of one, but I saw one, and I was just mentioning that I'm going to look in my log and see where I saw it. I saw it about 3 years ago. It was a life for me. It was exciting.
Oh.
And now I can't remember where I saw it, but I think it was probably either like in Simpson Bay or Cordova. I'll have to look in my log and see where it was I saw it, but it was exciting.
Well, get ready. They're coming.
But it was in the southern part of the sound. It wasn't up here near Valdez.
Okay. And Anchorage doesn't have them regular yet. I'm surprised that it's taken this long for them to get their first sighting or their regular any regular sightings. They have been seen in other parts of the interior of Alaska. So anyway, they're coming.
Do we know any side effects?
Not that I know of.
They're not pushing. They don't eat anybody. Saying.
Yeah, not that I know of. I'm hoping or like to think they're benign. But, you know, we've been taught a lot of lessons about invasive species, something to look out for. It's not known at this point if they're out competing anything.
Surely they're tasty.
They're probably good food for gyr falcons, peregrine falcons. They might subsidize some raptors, some predators. Okay, so that brings me to the birding part of this, the bird ID, and I've bit off a little chunk that I think is digestible for folks. I'm going to try to go through it pretty quick, and hopefully this will help people on the Christmas bird count of LBBs, little brown birds. And anyway, if you're out, they can really stump birders. You know, it's one thing to be able to identify these colorful, pretty birds that are showy, but there's a little segment, or actually a fairly large segment of birds, a lot of them are sparrows, that can just, you know, stump people and make people frustrated and just walk away and say, oh, I just saw a little brown bird, LBB or something. Anyway, if that happens on the Christmas bird count, you know, not everybody's an expert in various conditions, or if it's unexpected, some little brown birds can be kind of hard to identify. If that's the case, just take good field notes. Look at the bill shape, look at the bill color, look at the leg color, look at the markings. Even little brown birds have some you know, some markings you can pick up on. So try to make a little quick sketch and take a picture if you can. Even with your cell phone, sometimes you can zoom in and get some meaningful information, especially if it's at a bird feeder through a window, you can get pictures. So those are the kind of things that can help us figure out what you're seeing. But what you're going to see here is at this time of year, there's not a lot of them. So we can, you know, kind of have a digestible chunk, process of elimination can help you identify these. This is a kind of easy one. It's not a sparrow. Somebody, winter wren. These live kind of in old growth, mossy forest is where they spend the most time. They're a very small bird. They behave a lot of times more like a mouse than they do a bird. They're running up and down under logs, into holes and things like that, wood piles. Anyway, that little tiny erect tail and a thin bill, a little bit decurved bill, is characteristic of wrens anyway. Actually, the tail and the bill are. They're a pretty small little bird, and they have a beautiful song. They're not singing this time of year.
What do you call the bill? Decurved?
Decurved.
Decurved.
Yeah, it has just a slight downward curve to it. So anyway, and they overwinter here, but they're not a guarantee. They're a little bit secretive. And sometimes they stump us on Christmas bird counts, but it looks like this year is a pretty decent one, and people are seeing them fairly regularly, so we'll hope we pick them up on the count this year.
When's our 7 days start?
Tomorrow is count week.
Starts
count week.
Tomorrow.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, I got that. I'm going to talk about that here shortly. What's this?
Brown creeper.
Brown creeper. It's a little brown bird. It lives in the forest, in the dark forest. You hear these things before you see them. This is a secretive bird, and they like to land on the bark of trees and crawl up. Their behavior can help you identify them as well as the sight of them. They have a really cryptic back. Their back blends into the bark of trees, and they also have a decurved bill, a curved bill. And they have a niche of hunting up the sides of trees, looking up into cracks of bark as they go up. The converse of that are nuthatches. They're not little brown birds, so I don't have them in here. But they hunt down the trunks of trees, looking into the tops of cracks is a little bit of a niche for them. But this is a brown creeper, kind of a secretive forest bird. If you're in a woodlot or a kind of an old growth forest and you're hearing little chickadees and stuff, a lot of times they'll be feeding flocks of chickadees, nuthatches, kinglets, golden crown kinglets, hunting, foraging together as a flock. And be watching for a bird that kind of flies down to the base of the tree and then just starts working its way up the trunk, and then it'll fly down again. And again, they're secretive. It's not easy to get a good look at these, and we can easily miss these on Christmas bird counts. This is a little brown bird. What's this? Pine siskin. And this is getting into the finch family, you know, which are sparrows, but it has a real conical, pointy, short beak, more so than sparrows do. And then for me, what gives away pine siskins is that yellow wash on the wings. That none of the sparrows have a yellow wash on the wings like that. And they're usually up in trees. They'll eat seed that's on the ground as well, but they spend a lot of their time up in trees. A lot of sparrows spend a lot of time on the ground. And this is a fairly small bird, and they can drain your feeders pretty quick when they're here in good numbers. So this is the pine siskin. Has everybody got these so far? Pretty straightforward, often in big flocks.
And, you know, 8 to 10.
Yeah. And I'm not going into the calls here. That's another way to help identify birds. We're going to just do this visually right now. They have a little kind of a buzzing trill that can help you identify them. Now, sparrows can be tough. You know, they're the epitome of little brown birds. And in the summer, we have more than we have here now. But really, there's just a few sparrows that can be here in the wintertime. The song sparrow we have here every winter, and it's relatively common. They really look for cover and are often near the coast, although not always. They'll be along the riprap of the jetty and the harbor and along the Orca Road, you know, where they can hide in the rocks. They'll be around brush piles or where they can get under the decks of houses or things like that. They really stick to cover in the wintertime. They're a sparrow, but they have a little, sparrows are finches and have seed-crushing bills, you know, generally kind of thick bills. The song sparrow has a little thinner bill than a lot of sparrows do. And you'll see here, they're brown, but they have a streaked breast with a little bit of a central breast spot. This face kind of stands out for me. They've got a stripe through the eye and a little darker cap, but they have gray on their cheeks, which can really stand out. And even though, like you would say, that's a brown back, there's some patterning on the back. And I'm going to contrast it with another sparrow that we're also fairly likely to have in winter. There's really only two sparrows that are, well, this is the only sparrow that's common in the winter that we always have and always find. These other ones occur in much smaller numbers. This is a song sparrow right here. You can see that thinner bill, at least for a sparrow, that's sort of centralized breast spot and this dark streaking on the breast, and then just some patterning on the back. It's not a uniform color. And I'm going to contrast that with the fox sparrow. Now we're starting to have to look a little harder for these birds on our Christmas count. There's small numbers around. A lot of times they're near a feeder. Harry Curran's feeder always had great stuff, and it was a great place to look for fox sparrows, white crown sparrows, or golden crown sparrows, which we're going to get to here in a second. If you have some really long-term feeders, people who have been feeding birds for a long time are the best places to find these things, because the birds know where they are, and each winter come back, you know, to the same little patch, you know, expecting those seeds. So anyway, the fox sparrow doesn't have as much streaking on the breast, but it's well spotted. It also has a central breast spot. It has a thicker bill than the song sparrow does, and you can see here, it's not so much streaks, it's more spots. But I think the characteristic that really stands out for me is this back. It's a really uniform color, a real uniform brown or grayish brown, without any patterning like the song sparrow has. So those are the two sparrows that we're most likely to see around here. And, you know, I would get your bird book out if you see a little brown bird or a sparrow, and look at these two first. They're the ones that, you know, you can kind of, you know, either check off or eliminate pretty quickly. These other ones I'm going to go to occur in even smaller numbers, and we're always lucky to get these, and it takes usually some good bird feeder, you know, good observing around a feeder. The person that does the town route is the one who's most likely to pick up some of these things and be the only ones that we get on the count. This is what a golden crown sparrow looks like in the breeding season. Piece of cake with that bold black head with the stripe down the middle and the yellow on the crown. This one's feeding nestlings right here. But in the wintertime, we're not so lucky. They're not quite so bold. But you're going to see a little brown bird. They have quite a bit more streaking. And look for it. And it's sometimes quite subtle, but they have some wash of yellow on their head like that. So really look hard with binoculars and see if you can pick that out. And they're a big sparrow. To me, they look kind of big and fat and chunky. They're bigger than the other sparrows that we get around here.
He looks kind of like a song sparrow, except he doesn't have that. Is it just the yellow?
Yeah. The song sparrows will never have that, and this sometimes doesn't jump out at you. You have to look for it. But this is a stronger patterning on the back, and you don't have the dark streaking on the breast like a song sparrow does. So there are other differences, but look for that yellow wash on the head. That's kind of the giveaway. Yeah.
Really seems. I had a dozen of them.
In the springtime,
at the same time that the finches were there.
Yeah, they put on somebody whistled a song.
No, I can't do it.
Oh dear me, is one way to remember it. They, for a few weeks, stage in Cordova. They feed on the ground. If you throw seed out, you can get big numbers of them. And they're just beautiful. You can hear that song, you know, because it's starting to get light so early. Anyway, they're a neat sign of spring. In May, we get them in good numbers, and I think they stick around a little longer time than a lot of other migrants do.
Someone else's bird pictures? Milo,
I have pictures of them in breeding plumage, but I don't have them around feeders. I had to borrow a couple pictures for this. Here's another winter plumage golden crown sparrow, and look at that real strong patterning on the back, nothing going on the breast, and that wash of yellow on the forehead like that. Now, if white-crowned sparrows look like this in the winter, piece of cake, but they don't. You're not going to see him with his bright black and white crown. This is a white-crowned sparrow. In the wintertime, now these guys truly qualify as LBBs or little brown jobbies, LBJs. The best description for these birds is nondescript. You really have to start picking out things. But with this process of elimination, you can rule out these other few choices that we have right now. So that can help. I haven't seen one here in winter. Currents have had them at their feeders sometimes. In fact, that's probably the only place we've got them on Christmas bird count. But anyway, they've got a little bit of a cap here, a darkish cap. And they have this orangish bill. And that's kind of a carryover from how they look in the summer. In the summer, they have a bright yellow-orange bill, and that carries over in the wintertime. So they got that brighter bill. So you can look for that, but and they have just sort of a drab brownish breast. It's not a bright white breast or anything, but they're nondescript. They're going to be a tough one. This fall, in the southward migration, I had a few of these feeding in my yard, but they've long since left in October or late September. And I haven't seen them, and that was with the winter plumage golden crown sparrows that, you know, that were heading south at the same time, and fox sparrows. There were some really neat sparrow flocks in the fall in my yard, but they've been gone for a long time now.
Does that white crown sparrow have darker legs by any chance? It
kind of looks like I don't remember if that's a field mark or not. In fact, if someone wants to look it up, I got the Sibley guide right here, or we can look it up after. I don't think that's a field mark. I haven't seen that pointed out before. And then a few years ago, in my backyard up here at the Forest Service house, we had a white-throated sparrow wintering, and we got it. It was like the first bird we got on the Christmas bird count, because just as it was barely light enough, we went in the backyard and we could find it. And it looks like that golden-crowned sparrow, And in this picture, it looks fairly distinct, this white, this nicely bordered white throat, but it's not, it doesn't always jump out at you, especially if you're seeing it from the side or the back. And it has a little wash of yellow. You might think you're seeing, and the back is a lot like a golden crowned sparrow. But, you know, look at your golden crowned sparrows and see if you have a little whitish bib defined there. And it's, this picture makes it, this is the worst picture in the slideshow, by the way. It's all I had of this little guy. But anyway, this would be a great one. And Homer had some that same winter, and since have had some overwintering white-throated sparrows. So it's one to keep looking for. And then I've only seen this once or twice in Cordova. They're common interior breeder, tree sparrow. And they're actually, this was taken up the Power Creek Road in the winter. I don't think we've got many on our counts, at least since I've been doing it. They're kind of pretty. This is a reddish cap, and you can only see a hint of it from this photograph, but that's like a black spot in the center of a white breast. They have a really, you know, singular identifiable spot in the middle of their breast, and that singles them out from any other sparrow that we're going to have here. They look a lot like a chipping sparrow, which occurs in the lower 48, but we don't get those here. So tree sparrow is another one. That's it. That's really most of the little brown birds that we're going to get here. So anyway, there's through a process of elimination, I think you can narrow down. And it's worth trying. Don't just throw up your arms. We're not going to count little brown bird on the Christmas bird count. You got to get a little more specific than that. At least tell me sparrow species or something. And hopefully you can do better than that with this little refresher. With that, we're going to talk about get to the Christmas bird count here in a second, but I'm going to show you just a series of pictures. The winter's a neat time to get out and birding, and we usually don't do it, and I don't often do it with a camera. That's a favorite time of mine, and some of my favorite subjects are white birds in winter in snowy and icy environments. For me, it's just sort of the epitome of winter, these white birds in a snowy environment, and one of the photo opportunities that we have here are trumpeter swans. And another photographer illustrated this with pelicans for me once. In a slideshow, you know, they showed that, oh yeah, they like to photograph pelicans. And they showed some pelican shots. And you think once you get pictures of something, you can move on to something else. Like, why do you need another pelican shot? Or why do I need another swan shot? Well, he proceeded to show image after image of it after image, and I think his mom had asked him once, why are you going back to California to photograph pelicans again? And he went through image after image after image. Each one was different, each one was beautiful, and it kind of illustrated that's why you keep shooting the same thing over and over again. It's always different. You saw the trumpeter swan image that I had at the beginning of the presentation. I'm going to try to do that with two of my favorite subjects around here. One is trumpeter swans. And just because you photographed them once doesn't mean you can stop doing it, because, like I say, the lighting and the birds are always different. And I have a lot of fun with these. Power Creek is a great place to go on a nice snowy winter day to photograph these in the little open water patches. And another favorite subject of mine, more so than swans, they're not easy to photograph here in Cordova, but the Anchorage Hillside has some really good places. Glen Alps, Powerline Pass is a great place to see ptarmigan, and then Arctic Valley, the ski area, in the hills around there. If you're there in Anchorage in the wintertime, but better when the days are starting to get longer, like February, March, or April, bring snowshoes to Anchorage if you happen to be there for various reasons, and go spend some time and look for ptarmigan, because they're there in great numbers. They're somewhat approachable, and anyway, these little white ghosts are just a blast to try to find and for me to photograph. And I was going to show you how I like to play around and photograph these just beautiful, beautiful birds in wintertime. And these are all willow ptarmigan. Anyway, I can't get enough of them, and they're a spectacular, a white bird to me is a beautiful thing, especially the way they blend in winter. With that, I just want to talk real quick about the Christmas bird count this weekend, and I hope all of you will participate, and whether it's going in the field with a crew doing a route, or just watching your feeder. There's room for both. Feeder watchers are really valuable, and they turn up species that we're not going to see. Opie has been a regular reporting feeders. You guys have often done that. Anyway, I have a list of people that I'll contact. And do you still have a good feeder?
I have a feeder. It's empty right now, though.
It's empty right now? Well, you'll see right here. I'll give the hint. Stock up your feeders right now. In fact, throw some extra seed around. Let's try to get these guys coming. So hopefully we'll find them on Saturday. Count week is good, too. But, yeah. So here's kind of the rules and kind of what the Christmas bird count is. Right now, what they've kind of moved to is fixed dates. All national Christmas bird counts have to happen between December 14th and January 5th. This year, the 14th falls on a Saturday, so it's the perfect day for us. In fact, most of the counts in the state are happening on the 14th this year. In fact, sometimes we get people from Anchorage to come over to ours if ours is a different date than theirs. Well, that's not happening this year because everybody's got their own count on the 14th, just the way it fell. But they can take place as late as the 5th. Anywhere in that window is when you can have them. We usually try to do ours towards the beginning of the count window. It's a 7.5-mile radius circle centered at the weir. I'll show you a map in a second. That's what the count circle is, and that's a standardized national thing. Actually, it's becoming international. But a Christmas bird count circle is always a 7.5-mile radius circle. And on count day, you count all the species and the numbers of each species. You count the individuals, you know, the flocks. You know, that's 50 pine siskins. That's 1,000 common mergansers. You know, the numbers of them matter on count day. So everybody will have a form. I'll pass out the forms. And you'll go out in the field with that form and tally as best you can. It's like our deer pellet transects. It may not be rocket science, but it's science. And it's, the data is used nationally. It's a citizen science project that's used to detect trends in bird population, and it's been incredibly valuable because it's been done for over 100 years and has data from a very wide area. And even this, you know, sort of coarse scale has been useful in detecting trends in bird populations. Count week, you can count species towards your species total. And this is the kind of the friendly competition that sort of takes place with bird counts. People in Alaska want to count the most species, and Cordova can be very competitive with the species totals for the state of Alaska. We can have upwards of 60s or 70s on a really good year. It kind of takes a perfect storm of conditions to get that maximum number of birds. But anyway, we hope for a big count, and we can compete with other communities that have real diverse bird populations in winter, like Kodiak and Ketchikan, which have can have totals that high. If you live in Fairbanks, you're lucky to beat like 15 species. You know, in the interior, it's a pretty small number of birds that you're going to get. Where I lived in western Montana, we'd get in the 30s or something. So getting in the 50s and 60s is kind of fun. Count week is 3 days before and after the count. So count week for us starts tomorrow. So if you see, and I'm going to show you some most wanted birds here. They're the types of things that I want to hear about if you start seeing tomorrow on. It's better to get them on the count day, but we'll also take them on count week. So starting tomorrow morning, start listening for those owls, start looking for that dipper, you know, these things that we can often miss. Look for that pine siskin. Yeah, you can start looking for that because we might not get them on count day.
So at midnight, we can start?
Yes. Might get a calling owl after midnight. Yeah, we'll take it. So this is our count circle. I kind of updated my maps using this color photography with the GIS. And here's the count circle, the center at the weir, 7.5-mile radius. And in yellow is our road system. Here's town right here. Here's the highway. Here's the airport. This gives you an idea of how much area it covers. In fact, most of our count circle is wilderness. We just don't can't get there. If this is a city, you can imagine, you know, the access in which most count circles are in developed areas, and you can drive all over them. But we have very limited number of areas that we can get to, and it's kind of boiled down to 7 main routes with maybe some little sub-routes mixed in. But they are, the Copper River Highway is how we often break it down, White Shed Road, and sometimes there's a little subset that do Eccles Lagoon. There's Orca, South Orca Inlet and North Orca Inlet. There's the Town Route and Power Creek Road and the Orca Road. And start thinking, if you're interested in participating, where you'd like to go. And we'll make sure that there's a relatively experienced birder on each route, and makes it a learning experience. You can learn from these people, but you don't have to be an experienced birder to do this. And so start thinking, we might have to make some sacrifices for the team to make sure we have good coverage, but we'll try to honor your interests or the areas that you'd like to go, and make sure we get good coverage for all the routes. And then if we have plenty of people, we can cover some other areas. Sometimes people go up the ski hill, look for a ptarmigan, or go up to the ridge, or they'll walk the Eyak Trail looking for a woodpecker, which used to be a good place to find a downy woodpecker. Or there's always a group, the Smikes family and O'Leary's, who like to cover in depth Eccles Lagoon and the shoreline in that area. So anyway, there's some other places. We can mix and match and work things out. Here's the details. Most of you, hopefully many of you, got this in an email. Bill and Renee have graciously offered to host it this year. We don't have to all squeeze into my tiny little house like we've often done. And we're going to meet at 8 o'clock in the morning. If your email is on this sheet, I'll make sure that this gets sent to you so you don't have to memorize this. Bill lives behind the high school. And then in the evening, did we decide 7 o'clock, Bill?
Yeah.
Yes, in the evening at 7 o'clock, we're going to meet back there. So at 8 o'clock, everybody will show up. I'll have donuts there, and I imagine you'll have coffee out or something. We'll all get together, eat a little something for breakfast, and then just decide who's going to go on what route. It can be a little chaotic, but anyway, we'll get everybody lined out. Everybody will head out the door and then do their route that day. And there'll be time to go home and change clothes and come back to this little potluck. Please bring something to eat, just whatever kind of dish you'd like to bring. And at 7 o'clock, we'll have a potluck dinner. And then we all sit around. A representative from each route will be sitting in the room, and I'll compile the results. And that's really fun, because we can learn about what neat birds people happen to see. There's always some surprises in there. Somebody will see something that no one was expecting, or some huge numbers of something. Anyway, it's real fun, and there's also some friendly competition that goes on, or who sees the neatest thing or the most of something. There's usually a few neat secrets that are held up until the end. So with that, stock your feeders. Start looking for those hard-to-get ones. The count week starts tomorrow. Call me once you start seeing these, and I'll start keeping track of them so we don't forget about them. And let's hope for good weather. That can make or break us. And I see we have a little change in the weather coming. My God, last Saturday would have been a nice day to have a Christmas bird count. So anyway, yeah. And for the boat routes, it can be pretty nasty if you get a strong north or east wind blowing. Which has happened in many years as well, and it really affects what you can see. So we'll just see what happens, but we do our best. It's hard to get everybody. You can't get people to reorganize and do another day. We're kind of stuck with that day, so we'll just do the best we can. If it's a real nasty day, you do a lot more birding from your car or the harbor or something like that. So anyway, we'll just see what we get. And now I'm going to go through a most wanted list. I'll treat this like a quiz. So call out what this is, and we'll talk about real quick about where to find some of these. I think I put 10 or 15, maybe 20 birds into this. So what's this?
Rufus.
No.
Anna.
It should be Anna's, female costas, which we have had here once. And I haven't had it, well actually, there have been many reports of hummingbirds this fall and early winter. Some birds were sticking around, but we've had some very cold weather since then. And I haven't heard any reports since. But the one I'm expecting those reports were Anna's hummingbirds. And we would love to hear, even hummingbird species would be notable. And in the past, we've had Anna's hummingbirds on our count and Costa's hummingbirds on our count, which is just bizarre at this latitude to get hummingbirds in the wintertime. So it's a long shot with the cold weather we've had, but an Anna's or a Costa's hummingbird would be awesome.
Ring-neck
duck, yep. They're not rare. In fact, most of the birds I've thrown into this are birds that are probably here. We just have to find them. And there's not a lot of open water on Eyak Lake or the Eyak River right now, but whoever has the highway or Power Creek routes is going to want to be scanning those. And we'll have some spotting scopes available for those that don't have them. Make sure there's a spotting scope in each group. We want to find a ring-neck duck. That's one that we hope to get each year. It's not that unusual.
Glaucus
gull, second year. This is what Sue Ogle just saw at the burn pile. Wanted.
Now,
alive.
Can you tell us a little bit about how we tell it from others?
Yeah.
Second year?
Yeah. That you could tell it's a juvenile and not an adult because it doesn't have that solid gray back.
Yeah.
And of the juvenile gulls, that bicolored bill is a really good field mark. And they tend to have, compared to other juvenile glaucous wing gulls, which are kind of dark brown, they're just pale looking. They look real pale. This week, drive out to that burn pile or look at a fuel dock or look in those areas, and you might be able to pick it out. So that's where she saw it. She's going to try to get it tomorrow. She saw it today, in fact, Sue Ogle. Dipper, and you're seeing them right now on Eccles Creek.
Yep.
There's a lot of places where we can pick them up, Power Creek, the Weir. Oops. This is our white whale. They're here. I think they go up into the trees in the wintertime. They're not walking around on the ground. Sometimes around the airport, you got them on your trail if Casey doesn't shoot it,
yeah.
or Hannah. Don't you guys want to don't shoot it till after the count. If you count it on count day, if you shoot it on count day, we can count it. It was alive when we saw it. In fact, we've had the Losey boys go out and get us a ptarmigan on count day before.
It's kind of
beautiful. Yeah, it is. Yes,
yeah.
I'll show you this.
Because that's where we've been seeing them.
Recently?
We always see them.
A couple weeks ago.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a very good place. Mm-hmm. And I already showed you the count circles.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You did. I thought it was right across from the airport that it was still.
Mm-hmm. It's still there.
Yeah.
Will, what'd you do to make this work again?
What'd you do to make it not work?
I got too old. Okay. This is a tough one for us. They're here in the Alpine. This is a rock ptarmigan. Males have that beautiful black line between their eye and their bill. If you got into the Alpine, not on the flats of the Delta, but if you got into the mountains, like on the Heaney Range or the ridge above the ski hill, that's the ptarmigan that I think you're fairly likely to see. Dana and I have been seeing him in the springtime backcountry skiing on the Heaney Range several times now in recent years. It's a fun one to get, but it's a difficult one. Rock ptarmigan. Wilson snipe, that's a really hard one, and the fact that we've had some really cold weather freezing up all the little trickles around town can make it harder, but if you've had a mild fall in some little seeps around town, it's not that uncommon for us to get a Wilson snipe. This year, I think it's going to be a little bit of a tall order.
Kingfisher.
Yeah. Has anybody been seeing or hearing them?
They've been on and off in the harbor.
Yeah. And there's bait in the harbor.
Yeah.
Are you seeing all the, I was telling you about it.
Yeah.
There's herring in the harbor or some bait, and I think.
Last week we had one.
You did?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's a hard one for us to get sometimes. And there are some around right now, and there's bait in the harbor, which is going to help us out a little bit.
No.
No? It's your neighborhood owl. Western screech. Yep. And these guys are more often heard than seen this time of year. Dana or Michelle, have you guys heard of this fall? They've become less regular in the last couple of years. Anyway. You've nailed it before. You know, we've got it on Christmas bird count day, in fact, in the past. So we'll keep our fingers crossed on that. Northern hawk owl, that's a great one for count week or count day. They're always uncommon. Some years are better than others, but Paul Schwartzbart just saw one. So they're a hope on the highway route. We got one last year. Or a couple. Yeah. They feed on waterfowl this time of year, so that's a possibility, is getting a peregrine falcon. Merlin. Yeah, we could get a sharp shin or a merlin. This is a merlin right here. We can hope. This is a little bit of a
rusty
blackbird. This is a bit of a stumper. We can, yeah. In the lagoon, and sometimes in little timbered areas around the airport, we picked them up. They're a hard one to get, but occasionally we do. It's a neat one. And I could have thrown them into the little brown bird lesson in the wintertime. They're brownish like
they're
this.
They're kind of bigger.
Yes,
I mean,
yeah.
You really know you're not seeing your little
a sparrow,
brown bird.
Yeah, you do.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
A robin?
No, not as big as a robin.
Yeah.
These guys. Yeah. Do you have them now?
Here.
Huh?
Just last week.
You did?
Yeah.
So keep your eyes peeled.
Don't make a call during bird count.
No, they don't. Anyway, they're around here. They're secretive in the wintertime. But we often get them on bird counts. Bob Barron's is somebody we should talk to and have him look. He lives in a good place for him. So keep your eyes peeled starting tomorrow. This is not something we can hang our hat on, is getting a buried thrush.
Mm-hmm.
These guys don't burst out in song this time of year either. But I think we got a fight. It's a winter wren. I think we have a fighting chance of picking them up this year.
Black
cat chickadees. Yeah, Opie and I were talking about them. In town, we mostly get chestnut back chickadees, which are kind of a spruce forest bird. The black cap chickadees, like the alder of the Delta, is where they're most common, and they're not an easy one for us to get. Whoever's doing the highway route probably has the best chance of picking up a black-capped chickadee. I haven't heard anybody seeing a downy woodpecker lately. Suet feeders are good. Sometimes stands of snags, like an ibex, we found them before.
Oh, I thought it was a hairy, but it probably wasn't.
Hairy and downy are hard to tell apart. The hairy has a little bit longer bill, a little bit bigger bird.
I heard a woodpecker out of the burn pile a week ago.
Oh, good.
I didn't see it.
Yeah, and we've had sapsuckers out there. I think that's all I got. Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Do you want to be anything or not?
Have people seen birds with beak abnormalities that they've seen in South Central?
There's a few crows that have tended that way, but not much else. Anchorage has way more chickadees, especially, that show that. I don't know that we've come up with a bona fide chickadee with that beak abnormality.
Everybody know what I'm talking about? They're really long, where their beaks are just deformed, either really thick or really.
I've had a couple.
Like a crossbill, but even more exaggerated,
right,
than the crossbill beak, but it occurs in different species like chickadees. And no one really knows still at this point what's causing it. It's a national phenomenon, but it's well documented in Alaska, too.
Chickadees and crows are the main ones, right?
Uh-huh. Anybody else? Any questions?
Yeah.
Anyway, I hope we can see you on the Christmas count day. Sorry, Taya, that you have to take off beforehand, but she's been a regular, helped us out lots of times. And I'll be contacting people to shore up some of the routes and some of the feeder watchers the night before. I'll be contacting some of you, especially the regulars.
So I meant to ask you this earlier when we were talking. Do you have some kind of algorithm that you apply to a bird feeder count?
No.
So even if you count the same bird 50 times a day?
Well, you're really supposed to count the most you see at one time.
Okay.
And get a minimum count that way. If you have three collared doves on the ground at the same time, if you have one at noon and one at three, you really have to call it one.
The same three chickadees coming there 60 times.
Yeah, yeah. No, you can use a little interpretation and best guess, but the best way to do it is the most you can see at one time. So try to get some gauge like that, not duplicate the same bird. Yeah. All right.